good morning, new beginnings. Gosh, we're zipping right through February, aren't we? We had quite a few activities that have been happening. Last night we had our Saturday service again with questions of the Bible, if I remember correctly. So don't forget about that. Saturday evenings, there's food fellowship and lots of things. So the first week of the month, we do the Chosen. The second is some kind of activity. We'll announce that shortly for March. And then we talk about the Bible, we do fellowship, a little bit of Bible study, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, probably even some music sometimes. So anyway, don't forget about that. And then we also have our baby bottle campaign going on right now. There's bottles out in the back. We support CareNet. We've been doing it for years. It's such a great ministry, and we're very proud to be a part of that. And then we also have our membership class. So that's going to be March 5th at 11 o'clock. And I know I went through these announcements super fast, but we have some really great music and just want to get our hearts open and ready. And I think Victor's going to do that, get us prepared for worship.
Yes, let's bow our heads and pray, please. Heavenly Father, we lift your name up, give you all the glory, all the praise, Lord. You are worthy of all of our praise. Father, I pray over this entire congregation, this church, and everyone here. Pray dominion over every home and every family member. There are some who are struggling with more than I can imagine, things that they have to deal with. And Lord, I just ask that you comfort their hearts. I'm so glad that they're here. And I know that you are too, Lord. And together we're just going to worship your name and give you all the glory and all the praise, because that's what we're supposed to do, Lord. We're supposed to praise you at the mountaintops and in the valleys. And that's what we will continue to do from the rising of the sun to the setting of the same. I will praise your name. Amen.
No.
twice, but just don't get it right. Well, I talk the talk, I don't walk. Miss the moments right before my eyes. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy.
Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. John 14, verse 27. And I have told you these things, so that in me you may have peace. In this world you have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. John 16, verse 33.
Please grab a seat. Let's give it up for the worship team. I appreciate you guys so absolutely. First of all, Marcus wasn't feeling particularly good today or this week. And, it just keeps on coming and brings it every time. Just thank you so very much, Marcus. You're awesome, man. You're just absolutely awesome. And Victor, man, Victor smokes meat during the weekdays, and he smokes songs during the weekends. Awesome, dude. Just awesome. Thank you so very much. And Janet, man, oh, man, Revelation song, that was just awesome. Just great. It's just, if you don't feel or sense God's presence, I'm sorry. That's as good as it gets. That's as good as it gets. So I'm just thankful for you guys. You know, today we begin a brand new series. Do we have this? Okay. There's no lead-in slide. Okay, got it. Understand it now. We began a brand new series. I was hoping to try to give you the actual name of the series. It's called Peace of Mind, and it's about mental health. It's a Life Church series, and this is such an important topic because, to be honest with you, really, mental health has really deteriorated in the last 3 years. I offer you the following statistics. The World Health Organization last year did a survey, 25% increase in anxiety and depression in America. One in four pastors, 24% of the pastors, have had a mental health issue going on in the last 3 years. As far as Christians are concerned, another study says that 43% of Christians have experienced a mental health issue in the last 3 years. There is a lot of stuff going on. You know, I think it was when I was first starting into ministry in Western New York, I was serving at a church, and there was a woman who came in to volunteer. She would fold programs for Sunday morning. And she had only been coming to the church for a couple months, and it was nice to see her and everything like that on the weekdays as opposed to just on the weekend. So there have been times that I struck up a conversation with her, and just a nice lady, very quiet, but a very nice lady. And she was volunteering, and I'd see her pretty much on a weekly basis for, you know, a couple months or something like that. And all of a sudden, she stops coming. She wasn't coming, and I was thinking, she's probably just sick or something along those lines. But she doesn't come after a couple weeks, and I asked the church secretary, what's going on? And she said, didn't you hear? She committed suicide. I'm going, no, I didn't hear a thing. I didn't hear anything about a wake. I didn't hear anything about a funeral or memorial service. I didn't hear anything about anything as far as that is concerned. And I was just in the place where I was coming to realize and understand that there's a stigma regarding mental health in the church. Actually, in a study, it's 91% of the people in the church believe that there's a stigma towards mental health in the church in America. And perhaps the root of the stigma is based upon the idea that Jesus promised peace to his disciples. If Jesus promised peace, then why do so many Christians experience anxiety, chronic anxiety? Just anxiety that's you're thinking, what's going to go wrong today? Almost every day. Or they experience depression, feeling a certain degree of helplessness regarding problems in your life. Or even stress, feeling just overwhelmed with the responsibility that you have to handle. You know, Jesus definitely promised peace, but our world is not perfect. So he promised that we would have problems as well as peace. This is what he said. I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. And so, given the idea that peace is a spiritual fruit, right? We talked about it the last couple of weeks. Peace is a spiritual fruit. It's the second of the 9 spiritual fruits. So peace being a spiritual fruit, it doesn't come instantly. It's not a gift. So salvation doesn't necessarily mean instant serenity. So mental health has this stigma attached to it in the church. But mental health is also really significant in it being a determinant in how we process life, how we resolve stress in our life. How we bounce back from stressful situations, or we don't bounce back. Mental health is really a determinant as far as how we relate to people, how we choose friends, or how we relate as far as our marriage is concerned, how our marriage is doing, what have you. Mental health is also really a determinant as far as how we respond to choices in our life, how we deal with the stress and the coping mechanisms we decide on. You know, having mental health issues can be a place where we make the choice of an addiction over God in trying to find help and hope. You know, I've had more people say, you know what, this is really a cool topic that you're going to be talking on. And there is a need for this topic to be spoken about. But I also do with a certain amount of trepidation because I'm not a psychologist. I'm not a psychiatrist. But this is what I know. Our mental health goes up and down. It goes up and down based upon the idea of a number of different factors. Our mental health can be a function of what? The amount of sleep that we get. If we don't have enough sleep, you can get pretty wound up. or the hormones that might be raging, or relationships that we might be dealing with, especially particularly difficult relationships or something along those lines. It could be a function of as far as your exercise patterns or your diet. It could even actually be a function of health, faith. There was a study that was done. It was done by Tyler Gillis from Wellesley College, Dan Hungarian from Notre Dame, and Tamar Ustrom from Ohio State University. They did this study that has documented the idea that church attendance has actually reduced the number of deaths of despair during COVID. Actually, it was before COVID even. And deaths of despair is defined by suicide and also alcohol abuse. This church attendance has actually reduced that. And the question is, what is it involved with church attendance that has made that possible? And I've thought about this because it wasn't explicit as far as what the study found. But I've thought about it, and I think to myself, it's the possibility of having Jesus available to you. It's the message that Jesus is always available to you, even in the darkest of moments. David Brooks is a columnist in the New York Times. He wrote a column last week, I think it was, regarding a friend of his who died of depression, suicide. And in this column, he talks about how he tried to walk with his friend through his depression. And initially, Brooks said that he tried to talk to his friend along the lines of, hey, your life has got purpose. This guy was a surgeon. And you've got all kinds of purpose. You've got a great life. And that didn't resonate. Then he advised this guy to say, well, think about good thoughts. That didn't resonate as well. Brooks came to the place where he came to realize and understand that the only thing he could do, probably the best thing he could do, was to be that in that place of presence with his friend, to try to be with his friend to go through this thing, to try to do the best he could to just be present there. See, that when the church is at its best, that's what we offer. We offer Jesus, and to a lesser degree ourselves, to walk through the darkness of mental health issues with somebody who's suffering from that. But unfortunately, there are two things in the church that have been dangerous myths that we have not been very good for people who are suffering. And I'd like to talk to you about those two. The first one would be, Christians shouldn't struggle with mental health. We've placed the blame on people, on the person who is suffering under the anxiety or the depression or the stress. I'll be honest with you, I know this to be the fact because I've experienced it. The last 3 years have been hell. Absolutely hell. I know for you, but I also know for me. The stresses as far as the church goes because of COVID. Not to mention my wife. I've been chronically anxious, straight up. Cyclically depressed, feeling I just don't have any capacity. I don't have any agency to change this. And I've wondered, you know, is it that I don't have enough faith? Don't I pray enough? Do I have sin weighing me down that keeps me from being, my prayers being answered? This is what I came to the conclude. I haven't arrived as far as perfection, not by a stretch. But there, I know of a lot of other people who haven't arrived as far as perfection. That don't suffer under the same thing that I suffer under. So it's not a function of what I've done wrong. As a matter of fact, I can offer to you three biblical heroes who have suffered mental health, two of which I would offer to you were bipolar. The third one was just straight up depressed. King David. King David, talk about mental health whiplash. You talk about manic depressive. He had that manic moment as far as the feat of Goliath at the Elah Valley. And then just weeks later, he's got this time in Gath that he just has a mental breakdown. For those of you who know the story, David defeats Goliath, and he's just on a high. Everything's going great for him. Then Saul gets jealous, and he wants to kill David, try to retain the throne, and David is on the lam trying to go all over the place. He goes to the Philistines to try to find sanctuary there. One of the five Philistine cities is Gath. Gath, oh, by the way, is the hometown of Goliath. Well, the people recognize David in Gath. You're the guy who killed our hometown hero. So they go after David. David is freaking out. Talk about manic depressive. Next one, Elijah. Another manic depressive issue. He had the victory at Mount Carmel, right? He had the 450 prophets of Baal doing the sacrifice for Baal, crickets. Elijah offers a sacrifice to God, fire on high. Yahweh is the only God. Elijah is so jacked up, he beats Ahab going down to Samaria. He runs faster than the horse in the chariot. Dude is really jacked up. Jezebel threatens him, says, I'm going to kill you, son. Elijah's running for his life. Notice he didn't go to Jerusalem to the temple. He didn't trust anybody as far as Israel, nor Judah. He goes to Mount Horeb, the place where Moses got the Ten Commandments. And he's on his way. Let me read to you what he said after his first day on the going into the wilderness. I've had enough, Lord. Take my life, for I'm no better than my ancestors who've already died. Talk about manic depressive. You're talking about just a couple days after he had that manic moment on Mount Carmel. Then, the poster child for depression, Jeremiah. Jeremiah's ministry was a prophetic ministry to the people of Israel. At best, they ignored him. At worst, when they actually, you talking again? They wanted just to kill him. Jeremiah was driven to this. I curse the day I was born. May no one celebrate the day of my birth. I curse the messenger who told my father, good news, you have a son. Let me be destroyed. Let him be destroyed like the cities of old that the Lord overthrew without mercy. Terrify him all day long with battle shouts because he did not kill me at birth. Oh, that I had died in my mother's womb, that her body had been my grave. Why was I ever born? My entire life has been filled with trouble, sorrow, and shame. Ouch. Can you say pain? Serious pain. These heroes who struggle with their own mental health issues just tell us that if you're struggling, you're not sub-Christian. You're just human. That's the first. The second dangerous myth is that God really doesn't care about your mental health. And perhaps this is because there's many times when we pray and we ask God for something and he seems so distant. Maybe some people are thinking, you know, there's just this distance and I don't understand what's going on with God. So they're thinking, I got to try to figure out what's happening here. And they try to fill in the blanks as far as what's going on in their life, what their experience is. Maybe God is trying to toughen them up, or maybe God's too busy. He's got bigger fish to fry than your mental health issues. I actually had a conversation with a guy who said, you know, I got lots of problems as far as my car and my house and all this stuff that's going on with me. I got tons of problems as far as that is concerned, but I don't pray about it. I said, really? Why? He said, well, that's just small potatoes. I can take care of that kind of stuff. God's got a lot more important stuff than that. Really? Really? If you're tempted to think that God either cares, doesn't care, or marginally cares about your life, your mental health, I've got a couple of psalmists who would disagree with you. First of all, the psalms would be the sons of Korah. The sons of Korah were set up by King David as being the official worshipers, the worship team for the temple. Their whole job was to compose and sing songs to God, worship songs to God. The sons of Korah wrote Psalm 46. It begins with, God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. Notice always, always ready to help in times of trouble. The next one would be David. David, upon his reflection on that time in Gath, when he went haywire, when he had a nervous breakdown, he wrote this: the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. The righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes to the rescue each time. Notice, the righteous person faces many troubles. It's not the unrighteous. It's the righteous person who faces many troubles. But the Lord comes and rescues each and every time. You know, bottom line is, God cares about what's going on with you. He cares about your mental health. When you're hurting, he cares. Jesus said that God knows every hair on your head. He's got them all counted. Do you really think he's too busy to care? Might be time to rethink that one. You see, we can understand these things in a cerebral way, in a mental way. We can intellectually understand these things, but we can get mentally exhausted. There's so many times we can get mentally exhausted by understanding something in a cognitive way, but really not taking it into our heart. We can be mentally exhausted, just like King Asa. Asa was one of the best kings of Judah. Absolutely nailed it as far as Judah was concerned. He was faithful to God for 35 years. Asa was the one who got rid of all of the high places, all the Asherah poles. He consolidated the worship of Yahweh in the temple. Asa was the one who stood off against this Ethiopian army who came up, outnumbered the Judean army 2-1, and he stood up and he trusted that God was going to take care of him. That's what he did in the 35 years, his first 35 years. He was faithful to God. He was one of the best kings. But he became mentally exhausted. That was the reason why he took matters into his own hands in the last 6 years of his life and his reign. He did that in two ways. The first way was politically. See, what was happening was King Baasha of Israel, the northern kingdom, came up against Judah. They were threatening Judah. So what Asa did was, rather than rely on the time that he stood off against the Ethiopians and relied on God, he took matters into his own hands. He took all the gold out of the temple, he took all the gold out of the palace, and he sent it off to the king of Aram. I think it was Ben-Hadad. And he said, hey, let's make a treaty so you can break your treaty with Baasha, the king of Israel, and start attacking them, and they'll pull away from us. He did that. It worked out. But they became a vassal state to the Arameans. Didn't rely on God, relying on his own instincts and wisdom. The second thing came with his feet. Asa had issues with his feet. What they were, I don't know. I think they were more important than toenail fungus, but that was just my interpretation, okay? Hey. Trying to lighten it up. Come on now. Rather than go to God, he went to the doctors. He didn't really care as far as going to God. What creates this dichotomy between the faithfulness of Asa, the 35 years, and the unfaithfulness of Asa in the last six? It was mental exhaustion. It really centers around this idea of what happens is we think about the problems. Asa was confronted with many, many, many problems. I just highlighted the biggest problems in his 41 years as far as his reign is concerned. But there were many problems. Each and every day brings all kinds of trouble and problems, okay? And he just had these problems just accumulating, accumulating, and accumulating. And you get to the place where you go, I'm exhausted from the problems. And you have a checklist. Got that problem taken care of, that problem taken care of. And there's a whole new list of problems the next day. And he got exhausted. So how do we keep ourselves from mental exhaustion? Okay. Jesus was asked, what's the greatest commandment? What's the greatest commandment? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind. Love God with all your heart, soul, and mind. So what does it look like to love God with all your mind? Isn't it to focus on God's love for you? Isn't it to thank God for the things that he does out of his love for you? Isn't it to trust God for the loving things that he is about to do for you? Isn't it to just double down and trusting God has got your back? To focus on God's love for you. That's what to love God with all your mind is all about. And why is it so important to love God with all your mind and to focus on him? Because when you focus on the problem gets bigger, God gets smaller. When you focus on God, God gets bigger, the problem gets smaller. Right? The most important and most frequent thoughts drive your words and your actions. If you get nothing else, get that. Your most frequent and most strong thoughts drive what you do and what you say. See, when you can focus on God and his faithfulness and express love for him because he loves you first, that builds you up. It's not your strength, it's God's strength you're tapping into at that point in time. That's why Isaiah said, you will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust you. You. He's saying that to God. You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast. Those whose minds are focused on God and his faithfulness. When we trust in everything's going to work out, frankly, we're trusting in a pipe dream. Because our experience is that a lot of times things don't work out. But we can trust in the one who works everything out for our good. Right? That's what it is to love God with all your mind. The bottom line is that we're always going to have problems. Jesus promised that. But peace doesn't come in a problem-less world. It comes in the presence of Jesus, and that's our takeaway. As far as next steps are concerned, I offer you the four that you see on your connection card. The connection card is part of the program. If you've got a program, I'd appreciate you filling it out. I think you should have pens along with the connection card. On the front, you'll see a place where you can fill in your name. And if you're a first-time guest, we thank you for being here. You can just mark the first-time guest box and make sure that you grab a bag, a gift from us at the hub. And there's a place on the front of the card that you can fill in your prayer request. So if you got something that you would appreciate prayer for, we've got people who would love to pray with you on that particular topic. On the back of the card, you'll see these next steps. You'll also see some I'm interested in things. One of the things you don't necessarily see on the I'm interested in, but if you are interested in the membership class, it's going to be on the 5th, right after the service. You can just write in membership and mark that, okay? We'll get back with you on that, all right? So how about if you take a moment to consider what your next steps might be? How do you apply this message? If you're dealing with difficulty in your life, if you're dealing with mental health issues like me, it's always good to try to figure out, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Because there is relief. There is sanctuary in Jesus. There is peace that we can know in Him. We just have to access it. This is your time too. Please join me in prayer. Father God, there's so many times that we get into the each and every day, and it just seems we're thrown into the deep end as far as life is concerned. And we just feel we don't have the wherewithal to be able to keep our heads above water. And we just get anxious, and we get depressed, and we get stressed out, and everything in between. Life has troubles. And it's so difficult to try to maintain your mindset in the midst of that. Fortunately for us, Lord, you lend yourself to us. We can have your peace. We can borrow your peace when we focus on your grace, your goodness, your love for us, your help for us. Help us to do that, especially at those times when we are most vulnerable, when we just feel the whiplash of craziness in our lives. Help us to focus on you. Help us to have our mantra, you are faithful, you are good. I know your love, I trust in you. Help us to find that peace in the midst of all of the challenges that we face. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
You know, we have a special day today, right?
I know.
We got a birthday in the house.
It's
Kathy's birthday today. We're so glad to have you here. Just thank you so much. I mean, you come and play every week for us. That's fantastic. We love you. So I just want to talk a little bit about fear. The next song we're going to sing is about fear, and I'm sure Lisa, as Jen pointed out to us earlier, this is a pretty good song to precede her, you know, it's not easy to get up and talk in front of people and share your heart and all that kind of stuff, you know, especially, you know, some people are good at it, some people aren't. I don't consider myself to be that great at it, but just being obedient and following the Spirit to get up here and let it all out. I mean, that's mainly what it is. Pastor John talked about how we bring it, the worship team brings it. It's mainly just opening your heart. Yes. That's all we're doing.
Yes.
Is just open your heart. I mean, I've done a lot of music stuff, and that's what I've always strived to do, was to be able to open up, to connect with the people that I play with. And now, it's interesting playing here, because that's what this is opening your heart to God, letting it come in, and
yes.
just feeling it. And, you know, as a musician, that's what I do, but everybody has their own thing, you know. People aren't musicians. People, like, go through the regular their regular lives, whatever you do for a job, whatever you do with the people you come in contact to. That's what it is. It's just opening your heart, and I just feel so blessed to be able to be here and do what I love and be able to open my heart and share that.
Fire for love is all I feel. Always taught us that. How dare the church ask us to give more money? So that always stuck in my head and never understood it. Really never understood tithing. For 30 years, that stuck in my head. So I gave as little as I could or not at all based on not understanding in my life what tithing meant. Fast forward, I've been to this in this church for 6 years. 5 or 6 years, and this always comes up. This part of church always makes me nervous. You all, most of you know that we own a restaurant, that we've never had any money. All our money went back into the restaurant. So when someone says, just give $1 or $5, I had to borrow that money to put in the church. So it never made me feel comfortable tithing or this actual act of it. Still not understanding what tithing means. The people in this church are so amazing. So we search out people, talk about tithing, what it is, what they do, how they do it. Not one story is the same. Victor and I both came together one day and figured the common answer is just do it. No matter whether it's a dollar or if it's $50. That's still all well and good if you have it. When you don't have it, it's still overcoming that fear of what I will do without the $50. We struggled with that constantly. And then just little by little started putting stuff in for tithing. Always felt bad about it because it still wasn't enough. That isn't 10%. And then one day the light came on. It's not about me. It's about what this church does for the people in this church and what I get out of this church. Once I turned that over, it was much easier. So if I wrote a check, which is easy, I would forget the check the next week. And then I would forget the check the next week. So that wasn't helping me. And lo and behold, online, where you can put it in and not really have to worry about it. It's still a worry. It's still always a struggle. But until the last 2 years of our life, this is the first time we've ever tithed, and I don't even look at the amount anymore. And it's still a struggle. Money is always a struggle, always, in our life. We still don't have money, but I have no fear anymore. So my fears have turned into faith and has brought all of you into my life, which is the whole reason we come here, to help each other to overcome life, to overcome depression and things that we need. We have God, but we still need everyone in this church. So today I ask, give what you can, but it is a long journey. Thank you.
I know there. Tried so hard to play ahead, but you keep falling behind. Life's gonna pull you down and make it hard to see. But a little change in your point of view could be just what you need. There's always a reason to always choose joy. There's something deeper the world can destroy. Smile when you think it. Smile, get up and dance. Smile, there's bigger plans. Stick around. Working on sunshine, then here comes the clouds. You can laugh or you can cry, and it all falls apart. When I believe the more we laugh, the more you hear it. There's always a reason to always choose joy. There's something deeper the world can destroy. Smile when they can't smile. Get up and smile with your breath.
So the mark of a good message to me is one that makes me think beyond the moment. And this is one of those that made me think beyond the moment. I've been involved with churches my whole life, served under a lot of pastors my whole life. My father-in-law was a minister, and he had charge of churches all throughout New England. And this issue Pastor John talked about this morning was rampant in all of them, and never talked about. Satan wants to pull you from the crowd, from the herd, and make you do your thinking by yourself. That's no place to be. God offers a response to that in Matthew. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle, humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. For those of you who didn't grow up near a farm, that yoke was a wooden thing that put animals together, oxen or horses, and they could draw more together than they could individually. Doesn't mean that the things are going to go away. It means you don't have to do them alone. And it means God's going to make them easier when he says, I've got this for you. That's what this is all about. Think about that. Think about that a lot this week, what God can do for you. Go in his peace. We'll see you next time.